Perfumes are one of Italy's booming markets. Fragrances are experiencing extraordinary growth in connection to the emerging sector of wellness and spa, and constitute an integral, sometimes the largest component in the portfolio of major fashion companies, as we see in the success of brands like Acqua di Parma or top-selling products like Armani's Acqua di Gio or Versace's Bright Crystal. Why are perfumes such an important part of our modern life? What makes a fragrance such a desirable tool? What's in a scent? The word fragrance is related to the Latin verb flagrare, to burn and to smell, from which come our modern words conflagration, explosion, burning, hotness, and flare, smell, attractiveness, and cool. In its literal sense, as a product revamping or styling the body, fragrances confirm their link to spa and fashion. Scents, perfumes, and aromas, however, are tied to a much deeper cultural, religious, and social imagery, which connects not just to the ancient world, but also to a long-lasting Italian tradition in the practice of olfactory design. You might recall from the Gospels the story of the Magi bringing to Mary, Joseph, and the infant Jesus the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. What is significant in our context is that two of the three gifts are actually wellness products: scent, frankincense, and an aromatic oil, myrrh. Incense relates to God in the biblical tradition. In the Jewish liturgy of Yom Kippur, the high priest burned incense as he entered the Holy of Holies in the Temple of Jerusalem to present a sacrifice. In a similar way, in the Christian liturgy, incense is burnt in relation to the Eucharistic sacrifice of the Mass. Myrrh, a sap-like resin used to preserve and purify the body, was a funerary ointment for Israelites as well as for Egyptians or Greeks. So, while in a figural way the Magi's gifts foreshadow Christ's divinity and burial, in broader biblical terms, they refer to a precise set of meanings, associating scents to burning, purification, and anointing. So fire, water, and oils are the creative ingredients of a fragrance, but they are also symbolic elements of the divine. The Greek practice of using ointment to strengthen the bodies of competing athletes would become, for early Christians, a sacramental symbol of the strength deriving from the Holy Spirit. Beyond the religious connotation, expressed in funerals, liturgies, or wedding celebrations, as attested in the Song of Songs in the use of aloe and nard, cosmetics were held in high regard by Israelites, Egyptians, and Greeks, also for curative or medical purposes, as well as for hygiene and body strengthening. It is with the Romans, however, that perfumes started to be more pronouncedly related to pleasure. As we can see in the ruins of Pompeii or in the British city of Bath, thermal water certainly related to hygiene, wellness, and personal care, but it also offered entertainment, an occasion to socialize, and a sign of a person's respectability. Baths and spas were also crucial for the development of distillation techniques, which started to replace the direct burning of aromatic substances. In the medieval world, perfumes acquired renewed relevance in connection to the Arabs, who mastered alchemy and first introduced alcohol as a burning vector in the distillation process, as we see, for example, in the creation of rose water, a key component in religious ceremonies, medical preparations, and food flavoring. Another important trade of aromas and spices came from China, along the Silk Route opened by Alexander the Great and traveled by Marco Polo, and later from Japan with the import of cherry blossom and incense. Lastly, the medieval culture of fragrances developed in Europe around convents and monastic orders. Monasteries often included an alchemist or herbalist friar in charge of producing scented liquors, what we call grappa, lavender or orange blossom essences to scent clothes, or rosemary extracts to mitigate and purify the effects of the Black Plague. Rosemary would be a key ingredient for Europe's first alcohol-based perfume, the so-called Hungary water, prepared by a monk, according to the legend, for Saint Elizabeth of Hungary, a princess. During the Renaissance, flavors and aromas brought from the New World started to appear in courts, so vanilla, cocoa, tobacco, cinnamon, ginger, or pepper, and they indicated the wealth of their possessors. The input for transforming perfumes into indispensable self-fashioning tools in 16th century European courts, however, came from two Italian women. The first, Isabella d'Este, is the Renaissance woman par excellence, who, in addition to being regent of the court of Mantua, diplomat, patron of the arts, musician, gardener, fashionista, whose dressing style was widely imitated by European women, also operated a cosmetic pharmacy, distilling fragrances as gifts for other courts. The second is Caterina de' Medici, born of the most powerful family in Florence and betrothed to Henry II of Valois. Before her marriage to the French king, the Dominican friars of Santa Maria Novella, whose apothecary produced medicinal elixirs from herbs and spices or rose water distilled to disinfect homes from the plague, created as a gift for Caterina a special alcohol-based bergamot perfume and named it Acqua della Regina, Water of the Queen. Now the perfume is called Acqua di Santa Maria Novella, and the Officina Santa Maria Novella in Florence is the oldest perfumery in the world. Thanks to this gift, and thanks to the aid of her personal perfumier, Renato Bianco, later known as René le Florentin, Caterina de' Medici not only introduced fragrances in the French court as a self-fashioning symbol of status, hygiene, and distinction, but also launched the perfume culture in France. Following the extravagance of Louis XIV's royal court, France would become the leader in the production of perfumes and scented leather in the 17th and 18th centuries, and the province city of Grasse emerged as the world's capital of perfumery. Grasse still hosts the world's top institute of perfumery. So while France championed the European production of perfumes and a new culture of hygiene, Italian apothecaries continued to thrive in the 18th and 19th centuries, thanks to the work of two masters, Giovanni Maria Farina, who created the formula of the Eau de Cologne in 1709 after emigrating from Venice to the German city, and Angelo Migoni, who launched a renowned perfumery and hygiene shop in Milan in 1778, which would close in 1950 due to the post-war emergence of the mass markets. From their connection to cleanliness, hygiene, and health, perfume started to relate to fashion and lifestyle in the 19th century, and to a larger market from the mid-20th century, as seen in the launch of the first fragrances by Dior, Lancôme, Hermès, Estée Lauder, and in Italy by Gucci in 1974, Valentino in 1976, Crizia in 1981, and Laura Biagiotti in 1988. It is in connection with this story and this depth of aesthetic and cultural implications that I want to discuss today the figure of Maria Candida Gentile, Italy's top maître parfumier and designer of an innovative approach to the production of fragrances. Originally from Liguria, Gentile comes from a family of chemists and studied chemistry at the University of Florence. After relocating to Valle d'Aosta on the Italian Alps, she developed a passion for natural fragrances and moved to France to be trained by the master perfumiers of Grasse. She's the first Italian in the last 30 years to graduate from the Institute of Perfumery. Upon her return to Italy, she launched her own line in 2009. Challenging the standards of the perfume industry based on large-scale production and chemical synthesis, by way of her use of a high ratio of ingredients from real sources, her technique of manual distillation, and her idea of fragrances as a process of emotional and aesthetic combination of elements. Gentile is a unique olfactory designer, constructing smell as a laboratory of customization, combination, and artisanship, and viewing fragrances as poetic tools. In her work, the elegance of a blend does not coincide with the engineering of synthetic molecules, but rather with the magic of a slow hybridization of elements, with the alchemic combination of ingredients as part of a multisensorial narration. Elegance then coincides with eloquence. A perfume, in fact, cleans, purifies, styles, and enriches a person or an atmosphere, but first and foremost, it must tell a story. In the same way as an object in a book, like the Madeleine for Proust, connects us to a world of memory and imagination, so smell is the privileged sight to evoke mental geographies or excite the wanderings of the mind. In the same way as storytelling or painting, so for Gentile, the first impression needs to undergo a patient work of transformation from intuition to a tempered result. After a long combinatory game of weighing, mixing, smelling, and resting olfactory notes until a unique balance is reached. It's the same magic that, in another episode of the show, music director Corrado Rovaris described in reference to orchestra, when an opera finally comes together as a unique blending of different timbres, voices, and notes. This emotional and analogic approach not only sets Gentile apart from the logic of synthetic perfumes for deodorizing or trend-setting purposes, but also turns her products into tailor-made pieces of design, or in other words, into a poetic collection. The relationship between literature and perfumes is an incredibly interesting chapter to explore. For my purposes, I'll focus my attention on a few Italian examples from the turn of the 20th century to make my point. Olfactory notes are a key element not only in D'Annunzio's construction of nature as a lively and spiritual space, panismo, but also in his own practice, as the poet actually produced his fragrances, designing their bottles and labels. Scents and fragrances are also important in Illica and Giacosa's libretto for Puccini's Madama Butterfly, as tools to reference and evoke the Japanese setting of the opera. Tobacco smoke is a key scenic device in futurist theater, binding the audience and the actors in a common cloud or atmosphere, and visualizing the idea of the performance as a dynamic energy, combining different elements in an unrepeatable effect. The clearest example of the literary presence of smell is actually Collodi's puppet Pinocchio, whose nose also implies a heightened olfactory capacity. It's the same heightened capacity that babies have to sense their parents by their odor, and that adults can recover as the scent of an old book, a violin case, a flower, or a well-loved aroma allows us to regain the lively and affectionate memory of something in the past. In the same way, Gentile conceives of perfumes as aesthetic sites of memory and imagination, as powerful and evocative tools capable of activating the concreteness and freshness of an experience or a remembrance as a lively event. In this sense, a fragrance is not just an object, a bottle scent, but rather a quality, an ever-burning freshness or presence, allowing one to trace the recognizable flair or contours of a personality. Fragrances design a space of recognition and association, opening a much broader landscape, which we cannot completely grasp unless we are willing to follow their intrinsic logic of combination and analogy. As for the futurists who saw in the vaulting movement of cigarette smoke a metaphor of a new analogic reason or artistic sensibility, Gentile's scents similarly become carriers of old stories and creative elaborators of new connections and meanings. As Gentile puts it, I create stories with my fragrances, inspired by other stories, books, music, places, people, until they become my own. It is in this overflowing of perfumery into poetry, design, special geographies, and architecture, and at the same time, it is in this tapping into a deeper and almost ancestral dimension of smell that Gentile's fragrances find their authenticity, genuineness, and innovativeness. Here are a few examples. Hambury was born of her visit to Villa Hambury near Ventimiglia in Liguria, close to the French border. Gentile recalls that day in February when Villa Hambury was battered by the wind and she was alone observing a storm on the sea. And here is her literary take. I was so caught up in that moment that in my mind's eye, I traveled back in time before the garden was destroyed during World War II. And I saw Lady Dorothy wearing an elegant white dress and a big straw hat on her head. I was there with her and inhaled and smelled the heady aromas of flowers in full bloom. In Finisterre or Lancaran Forest, Gentile connects the olfactory notes with the story of her travels to the immense ocean near Santiago de Compostela or to the mystical and magical forests of Lancaran bordering Iran and Azerbaijan that legend says were visited by Alexander the Great. Her perfumes, then, express a dialogue with other arts, with cinema, as in Barry Lyndon, replicating the character of Stanley Kubrick's movie, with music, as in Gershwin, paying homage to the American composer, or with poetry, as in Pineta dopo la pioggia, directly quoting D'Annunzio's famous poem The Rain in the Pine Wood, or in Sideris, matching Cesare Pavese's poem In the morning, you always come back. Lastly, going back to the biblical imagery, perfumes establish a connection with the religious experience, as in Anime Sante, inspired by a religious procession in Puglia, or in Exultat, reenacting Gentile's visit to a Roman church through the combination of profane elements, violet and vetiver, with the sacrality of incense. In addition to their poetic space, perfumes also represent in Gentile a physical, or rather an architectural space. The Italian master perfumier is a sought-after nose, not just for her craft in tailoring fragrances for VIPs like Madonna or Caroline of Monaco, but also for her artistry in shaping the atmospheres of retail spaces and expositive pavilions, as in her work for Ferragamo, Cartel, and Milan's Salone del Mobile, the world's top exposition of furniture. Gentile also worked on artistic projects for museums, as seen in the Venice Biennale, or in the powerful installation, Once Upon a Time, that she produced for the Hammer Museum in Los Angeles, dedicated to Pinocchio, and featuring an olfactory rendering of Collodi's story. The olfactory space has also a therapeutic component in Gentile's work, as seen in the laboratory of olfactory stimulation that she set up for patients with degenerative neural diseases in the Venice hospital San Camillo al Lido. In a recent interview, she relates her experience of covering the patient's eyes, exposing them to chocolate or orange scents, and asking them, where in your body do you feel it? Which music or color do scents evoke? What do they inspire you to do? In commenting on their answers, I hear the music I listened to when I was a child, patient said, sometimes laughing, sometimes crying. She added, for those who could not express themselves by drawing or speaking, those scents restored the freedom to feel, to sniff, to sense the world. It is this freedom, authenticity, and depth that constitutes her original way to innovation. Her alchemic process grants uniqueness over standard. Her expressive combination of spheres grants authenticity over stylization of patterns. And her poetic mode grants her depth, transforming a product from a commercial item into an epistemological platform. It is this personalization and culturalization of experience that ultimately makes a product, and not just the perfume, always fresh and fragrant. Thank you very much for listening, and don't forget to subscribe to the Italian Innovators YouTube channel or to the webpage www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications of new episodes, the lessons of the Italian Innovators course, and updates about my online lectures. You can also follow me on LinkedIn or Instagram, Facebook, Twitter for additional materials about the show. Thanks again. Arrivederci e alla prossima.